Additional concerns are now popping up about air monitors and other devices used to detect chemicals in the air in East Palestine. These devices were used extensively, especially in residential air tests, giving folks the idea that it was now okay and safe to return home. Status Quo reported on this pretty extensively back in March. Nonetheless, there has been some kind of new reporting on some of this information. A couple new experts are really speaking out about this with some additional details. So let's dive right into it first with a thread of tweets from Dr. Andrew Welton, who's been very outspoken about the EPA's response in all of this to date. He has complained about all sorts of elements of this, from the lack of clarity of information being provided by the EPA, some of the testing that they're doing that has been, again, unclear, and some of it done in different ways than independent testers would have done. So let's get into his thread of tweets here, pointing out some of this information, specifically on photoionization detectors, which, again, if you have been listening to me here at Status Quo, we've talked quite a bit about this. So let's go through the thread here. Sadly, unsurprising. We warned about this. It is not uncommon. PIDs are used inappropriately like this, as they were in Ohio. Our testing of a PID showed it was basically useless. All failures have been avoidable and placed health at risk. And we'll actually take a brief look at this new article that did just come out. I'll read a little bit here from it. Quote, federal and state officials engaged in a tense back and forth over how to alert the public about a problem in their response to the fiery February train wreck and chemical spill in East Palestine, Ohio. Though EPA officials have repeatedly reassured the public that detected chemical concentrations in the air, water, and soil, including for butyl acrylate, are below levels of concern, handheld detectors used to screen homes may not have been sensitive enough to sniff out butyl acrylate at low levels in the air, according to records obtained by E&E News under a public records request. Meanwhile, mistrust of federal agencies and its state counterparts linger in East Palestine as the massive cleanup continues. Now, I have some thoughts on this in general. Number one, a public records request was wholly unnecessary here, considering the EPA admitted this in a public hearing at a town hall back in March. That's where I got some of the initial information about a story that I was already working on regarding this, and they put this out here. That's besides the point. We'll get into some of that reporting. I'm just glad that more people are starting to talk about this and that Dr. Welton is bringing this back up again to help elevate this issue, because clearly it is an issue, and these are similar devices that we saw starting to be used in other instances. Back when we saw that plastics fire in Indiana, that was another instance where PIDs were being used in addition to other devices as well, but PIDs clearly not the device here, and we're going to get into a little bit more of the specifics now as we continue on in this thread. Here's a perfect example. PIDs in the real world don't tell you what you think they do. For decades, sewer pipe workers thought that they did. They don't. As you increase chemical air concentration, sometimes PID signal increased, sometimes it decreased. And we can see here, this is two graphs comparing the use of a PID on the left-hand side, the y-axis, and on the x-axis on the bottom, GCMS, which is a much more accurate lab method used for testing. You can see that in some cases the PID will show more, in some cases the PID will show less. The major takeaway is that it's not showing the same thing, unfortunately, in many of these cases. Dr. Welton continues, NIOSH has known that PIDs can't reliably measure individual chemicals in complex atmospheres for more than a decade, and the devices are affected by a bunch of factors. In some of these articles that Dr. Welton linked here, it includes things such as the calibration of the devices leading to vastly different responses from the detector. It also leads to when you have a mixture of chemicals that need to be tested for, it not giving accurate results as the mixture is messing with the detectors themselves, which is definitely an issue that they would have run into in East Palestine, as well as with the calibration. So those are a couple of those articles there. We'll make sure that this tweet thread is linked if you'd like to do some further investigation into them. Dr. Welton continues, so it was shocking to see that responders, including the US EPA, were allowing Norfolk Southern to claim indoor air was safe with PIDs. More to come, unfortunately. This failure to protect the public from harm by inappropriate device use goes to the heart of competence. Here's another study showing PID response compared to actual chemical air concentrations. They are sometimes off 10 to 1,000 times. 10 to 1,000 times. We also found before the Norfolk Southern disaster that some firefighters thought PIDs could tell them exact chemical concentrations when they responded to hazmat incidents. Our tests showed that they couldn't, so we penned this for firefighters. I'll read a little bit of an update from this article. He mentions specifically, and I quote, photoionization air testing meters, also called PIDs, cannot reliably quantify chemicals of concern at CIPP worksites. This is because the device is affected by multiple chemicals present, even if the device reports a single compound like styrene. The concentration of these devices can be 10 to 1,000 times off the actual chemical air concentrations. Lastly, to hit the nail on the head, Dr. Welton finishes with just a couple more thoughts on this, saying, number one, independent experts should have been brought in to run point on this. Number two, independent experts can still be appointed to advise. Number three, state and US EPA disaster response decision-making must be overhauled. This response is sadly a trend not unique to this disaster or leadership. He continues by saying many of these mistakes could have been avoided if state and federal agencies just made the right decision. Additional harms could also be avoided if actions were taken by EPA and others. I'll add to this just saying that Dr. Welton penned an open letter to the EPA, what's been months ago at this point, offering to try to help, pointing out many of these issues. He's tried communicating with them on multiple occasions, from what I understand, and for the most part, they have ignored much of his requests. I will try to follow up to see if that is still the case, but as of what I've been seeing, you know, following his Twitter closely and also speaking with folks who interact with Dr. Welton on a regular basis, that continues to be the case thus far. Now, I mentioned some of our earlier reporting on this, and I'm going to get to it, but first off, how the hell are we sitting here in June now? This happened back in February. How is it June of the same year, 4 months later, and basically only Status Quo and this other news organization that I had not heard about are the only ones reporting that these handheld PID devices don't work? I'm sorry, but the resources that Status Quo has, meaning just like Jordan, Colin, and a handful of folks like myself who are freelancers, how can we do the digging into this, reach out to the experts on this to prove this back in March? Yet there are not stories on CNN about PID detectors. There are not stories on Fox News about PID detectors, and not even just the detectors, but the fact that these detectors are used to tell residents that it is safe for them to return to their homes after a chemical explosion was set off in their town. This is what is being done by our federal agencies. The US EPA is okay with this. They're okay with this. They have not course corrected on this. Experts such as Dr. Welton have reached out on multiple occasions, from my understanding, to try to sound the alarm on this stuff, things like this, not just the PIDs, but on other issues as well. And they do not course correct. This is obviously clearly a problem. Let's get into some of that reporting that I did, again, back in March on this story. Headline, East Palestine bombshell, EPA official admits it may be missing toxic chemicals in air testing, admits some of its decision-making has been to prevent lawsuits. Again, we'll first start off with some of the butyl acrylate information, and rather than me explaining it, I will directly show you the video of EPA official Mark Durno admitting that these PID detectors used in residential air tests cannot pick up butyl acrylate until it is 5 times above the action level. Colin, we can go ahead and play that clip.
The machines, both the machines that were used in the homes and the machines that are hanging on the telephone poles, they some of those are multi-gas meters where we can see hydrogen chloride and carbon monoxide and a bunch of other gas sensors. But they also have that photoionization detector, which is that organic meter. It goes down to 0.1 parts per million. Now, the problem with that is our final chloride action level the long term was 500 parts per billion, which is 0.5 parts per million. So just above that level of detection, right? The butyl acrylate is, after the emergency phase, we drop that down to 20 parts per billion. So we can't see that lowest level of that machine. All right, now, that's important. But you can smell butyl acrylate at much lower levels. So yes, there is a chance that chemical could be present and we don't see it with that machine. I mean, you need to understand that, right? Butyl acrylate's an irritant. Right, it can cause some of the symptoms that people have presented. If that is what's causing it, I don't know. But again, we can see to a certain threshold with those machines.
So again, to quote Mark Durno himself there, we can't see that lowest level. That's important. He also notes that the odor threshold of butyl acrylate is lower than what the detector can pick up. That means if you can smell butyl acrylate, it already may be a level of concern before that device is picking it up. That is the case with several other chemicals as well. The article that was put out recently by E&E News does not mention that these PID detectors also cannot pick up the chemical phosgene. Phosgene is a known byproduct of vinyl chloride when it is set on fire, which is exactly what happened in East Palestine. Phosgene is absolutely going to be a chemical present in all of the chemists and toxicologists that I've spoken with on this. In the article, we mentioned some of them specifically. One of them, Aaron Bragg, notes phosgene is not going to pop up on here. I've got other toxicologists on and off the record saying the exact same thing. Phosgene was literally used in chemical warfare, okay? So that should obviously be a major red flag that the device being used inside of people's homes to tell them that it's safe can't pick up phosgene. I will continue though, because another one not mentioned in this article, formaldehyde. Formaldehyde, while it can be picked up with a PID device, it needs to have a special attachment on it. It then needs to be turned into a specific mode to be able to test for that type of chemical. Very notable here, when you are testing for that type of chemical like formaldehyde, it's one or the other. You can test for formaldehyde or you can test for some of these other things. Meaning, if you're not just testing for formaldehyde, you're not going to pick it up. Or if you're just testing for formaldehyde, you're not going to pick up the other things. On dozens and dozens and dozens of residential home tests that I have seen myself, that I have after speaking with residents, I have not seen formaldehyde listed once on any of these residential air test devices provided by CTEH, the contractor hired by the railroad, who were in the homes alongside the US EPA doing this residential air testing. Yet another one though, hydrogen chloride. That's another one that, again, when you've got this mixture of chemicals, it's not gonna be exactly accurate when you're using these PID devices. There are a million issues with how the residential air testing was done. Residents were absolutely gaslit into being told that everything was fine. Contractors that were hired by both the US EPA as well as the railroad both have track records of needing to kind of hurry these things along to make sure everything is all good and fine. Again, those contractors being CTEH and Tetra Tech. We reported on this fairly extensively at the beginning of this crisis. But again, we are now sitting in June. This happened in February, March, April, May. We are 4 months into it, approaching 5 months. The EPA has not course corrected. Fortunately, you know, you've still got experts like Dr. Welton trying to speak out, but what good is it doing if the EPA isn't acknowledging it? What good is it doing if the only people reporting on this are outlets like Status Quo? And again, I'll give some credit to this other E&E News, but I've never heard of them. So where is CNN? Where is Fox? Where is MSNBC? Where is the Washington Post? Where are all of these massive media outlets that have a shitload more resources, frankly, on this, putting pressure on these agencies? I've yet to see it. I hope that, you know, there is some course correction here and that we get some sort of semblance of justice for these residents of East Palestine. Unfortunately, I don't know at this point. I don't know. If you're able to continue to support some of the reporting we've been doing on East Palestine, the only reason I've been able to get into some of these stories months before these other guys is because I've been on the ground on three reporting trips, about a week long each, to East Palestine. I will be going back again at some point this summer. We also have been covering all sorts of stories related to Flint, Michigan, Kalamazoo, other environmental, chemical environmental disasters that are man-made going on across the U.S. If you want to help support our reporting, statusquo.com/join is the place to do it. That is the best place. You can also give me a follow on Twitter at LewisD217 to stay updated on some of this. Thank you all so much for watching and have a great day.